Okay, this morning we're going to do a little early morning update because we have a special speaker today. You want to get online, by the way, and watch the lectures of Dr. Martin Erdman this morning, or the sermon and lecture presentation. Today I'm going to focus on time of the signs. I'm going to try to get through everything that I have. I have about 150 slides. Some of them are videos. I may truncate some of my comments, but it really is an interesting time. I was conversing with somebody on Facebook this morning that I take sort of the whole of the prophetic scriptures and try to see how those might play out in our world today. And I can say to you that almost everything I pick up now relates to the themes of Bible prophecy. It's an amazing thing. It's almost impossible to keep up. I spent a lot of hours yesterday and today and trying to cut things down. And so what you're getting is a truncated, shortened, abridged view of the pile of information that I have available to me each week. So I try to pick out the important things as we see the signs of the times converging. It is a very chaotic world. I sort of made up this graphic. The chess pieces of the world have just been strewn all over the place, and it is a very, very difficult time to navigate things. So I'll be a little bit jumbled at the first. I kind of bounce back and forth between some ideas, but I want to just let you know a few things that are going on. One of the biggest signs of the end times, though, is false teaching in the church, and it seems that these conferences proliferate. Here is a conference that's taking place at Holy Trinity Brompham in May. This is Nikki Gumbel, the Alpha Course. You can go to deceptioninthechurch.com, that's Sandy Simpson's site, and look up things about the Alpha Course. It's very problematic. You see a number of speakers there. You see Priscilla Schreier. Of course, John Gray. You see a Roman Catholic cardinal who'll be speaking there. Some people from the Church of England, a troubling mix of different speakers, some very postmodern, none of which would I consider to be Orthodox Christianity, but this will be a very popular conference. John Gray is from Joel Osteen's church down in Houston. And it's just another example of where I think the truth will be assaulted. Time Magazine's cover this week is Truth Dead? Now, I think they were the ones, I could be wrong, that had the cover many years ago, Is God Dead? So they've gotten rid of God, now they're going to try to get rid of truth. But I know from looking at things on my Facebook feed and that type of thing that people are really concerned about, how do we tell the truth? How do we know what's fake and what's not? Because there's a lot of information out there that's just, it's just made up. And so a good rule of thumb is if the website has a name that seems like it's made up, then it probably is fake news. And if they've given you fake news in the past, they're probably going to give you fake news again. For example, I saw a story about Trey Gowdy having the body of Vince Foster exhumed and an autopsy taking place. And I just don't think that's true. I think that would have been all over the mainstream media. I don't know that Trey Gowdy has the authority in his role as a senator to order such a thing. I've never heard of it. So when I see that, but it gets passed around like it's real because three fake news sites have it on them. So you have to be very careful because truth is really important, and to a Christian, truth is of the utmost importance. And I do think that God gives us some common sense so that we can sort of decipher through the things that we're assaulted with. In the editorial page yesterday of the Wall Street Journal, they even took a look at sort of the philosophical basis of what's going on campus today. And the article is titled, the editorial is titled, The Postmodern Intellectual Roots of Today's Campus Mobs. And they go back and they look at the fact that what has happened in on the campus particularly and on the left politically is that narrative has become what controls. So the story is what's important. So people talk about the narrative, the story, and you see people get very upset when facts come out that don't allow them to push the narrative that they want. For example, when Congressman Nunes came out this week and said that, yes, there had been surveillance conducted, he had seen transcripts of surveillance that had been ongoing, maybe on another party, that had picked up members of the Trump transition team. Then Congressman Schiff, who is a man of the left, came out and he was very upset with Congressman Nunes for what he had done. Why? Because the facts that Nunes had brought out were preventing Schiff from continuing with his narrative, his story that he wants to push about this massive conspiracy between members of the Trump administration and Vladimir Putin and Russia. Now, I have a take on that. I'll give that to you in a minute. But narrative is very important, and you sometimes have to look at these things. Look, I'm an attorney. I have a big hearing in Indianapolis this week, and I'll be spending most of today and tomorrow and into the night preparing for that hearing and gathering facts and evidence to present to the court. But if what I present to the court isn't based on truth or actual evidence, actual facts, I'm going to have a problem with the court. And this is what's happening in our culture. And so when you see news magazines, and 2 Timothy 3 talks about this, that in end times men will be given over to fables, they'll be given over to myths, to stories. And so as this become, and so when you see mainstream news articles talking about truth and why we are having such a problem in our culture today, you ought to take notice. So Time's doing it. Now, Time's doing it for a different reason, I think, than the Wall Street Journal is doing it, but it's being done. And here's something. I've talked about this before. Gay activists are going after an IBM executive in Australia because he had the audacity to say that he supported traditional marriage. And so they've gone and they demanded that IBM fire the guy because obviously, you know, you guys support same-sex marriage. He doesn't. Therefore, how can he be part of your organization? And Christians need to be aware that this is what the left is going to do. Because when the left can't control so in other words, this man may be the most competent executive in all of IBM. But that doesn't matter to the left because he's not politically pure. So when the left goes around and accuses people of being fascist and controlling thought and that type of thing, understand they always lie and they always project. They're the ones who are the fascists. They're the ones who are lying. There's a new book coming out. This will be out May 17th, called What is the Bible? By Rob Bell. How an ancient library of poems, letters, and stories can transform the way you think and feel about everything. Now, there's some previews online. I haven't had a chance to review those yet. He did do a series of blog posts about the Bible. Those have been taken down from the internet, and the message there is you can buy the book. But there's one miraculous thing about the internet that captures pictures of websites as they existed at the time. It's called archive.org. So if you can get the URL, copy it from where you go to look up Rob Bell about the Bible, you can actually go to archive.org and you can actually pick up that six-part blog series that he did about the Bible. And there you can probably save yourself some money in spending it on a book that you don't need. One of the characteristics of Rob Bell's books is that he sells them for full price. I think the list price for What is the Bible is about $28 to get the hardback version and about $15 for the Kindle, which is really above what most books sell for. But the interesting thing about Bell, that what he did in his prior books, Sex God, Velvet Elvis, Love Wins, was that when you got the book, and I bought one of them, I read it, and I threw it away because I didn't want anybody else to come across it. I bought Velvet Elvis, just so I could be sure that he was as bad as I had been hearing about. He uses a lot of white space on the pages of his book. So his book might be 200 pages, but if you took out the white space like most books do, it would probably be about 50, but he's charging you a premium price for it. So it's a pretty good, to my view, it's a pretty good way to make money. But I will tell you that the best way to look at a Rob Bell book is like this, where you blur out the text and the most value you will get will actually be from the white spaces on the page. In fact, you know, there's a guy that wrote a book about, it's like 280 pages long, and it's called Reasons to Vote for Democrats. Have you heard about this book? I think that's the title. And it's one of, it's like number one on Amazon. I don't know if it made the New York Times bestseller list, but it's 280 blank pages in the book. And I thought, man, why didn't I think of that? Because I could have thought of that. And this guy's going to make $1 zillion off of this thing. And it's all white spaces. And so that would be a good idea for Bell. Now, the narrative of what you've been taught or heard in the media is that because Trump came to office, because Trump is a right winger, because every white winger must be an anti-Semite or anti-Jew, the narrative has been that there's been a large number of phoned-in bomb threats at Jewish cultural centers all across America and other countries. The narrative in the media was that happened because Trump had created such a climate of anti-Semitism by his mere existence on the planet that anti-Semites felt free to come out of the shadows and call in bomb threats and do that thing. Well, what's the reality? The reality is they arrested an African-American man who had been has been charged with calling in these bomb threats to 8 Jewish centers in the United States. He's African-American. He is a leftist. And he was doing it supposedly because he had some problem. He was trying to impress his girlfriend, which doesn't say much about his girlfriend if that's what will impress her. And then just this week, a 18-year-old joint Israeli-U.S. citizen in Israel was arrested for all of the other bomb threats that he had been calling in to these centers all over the world. So here's what's happened. The narrative that the media has been pushing for the last month or 2 months about the anti-Semite Donald Trump, proved by the fact that these threats are being made, has proven to be false, made up. Now, do you think that there is one person on the left that will apologize for that or correct themselves publicly? Will Paul Krugman or any of the other nuts that write for the New York Times, will they do it? No. Will any of the fever swamp over at MSNBC, will they do it? No, because truth is not what they're about. They're about making up a story to make you feel something. This is an interesting graphic. I can't remember where I got it from. If you see, there's Trump, but the shadow is Putin. And this is what the story has been for some time now. Now, I went to a lecture the other night by Trevor Loudon. Trevor Loudon is a New Zealander who has done a tremendous work called The Enemies Within. You need to go buy that. I don't make a lot of recommendations about buying things because I know people have limited resources. But The Enemies Within is worth whatever they charge for it. It might be $19.99. You may be able to rent it on Netflix or something. Trevor Loudon, The Enemies Within. It is a phenomenal piece of work. And what Trevor talked about the other night was the fact that we have been infiltrated by Muslim Brotherhood operatives, by Muslims at many levels of our government, and by communists. And the Communist Party for decades has been pushing to get their views, their Marxist views, within our government. They took over the labor unions, they've paid people, they've contributed to people, But the main point that Trevor was making the other night was what he calls the Green-Red Alliance, the Muslim-Marxist Alliance. And he used one example in his talk was Keith Ellison, who used to be a rabid Marxist who then went to the Nation of Islam and now is probably a stooge of the Muslim Brotherhood. He certainly pushes their agenda. I raise this in the context of the narrative that's being pushed in the press that there is a close alignment between Trump and Russia. Now, that's been pushed for weeks. I have not seen any evidence that supports it. I suspect that my own personal take on it is that during the election, I personally believe the Russians thought that Hillary Clinton was going to win. And so what they did was they went after Hillary Clinton, even though she's probably in their pocket from a political and intellectual standpoint. She's been a rabid leftist her whole life. But they thought she was going to win. But Russia has interests unique to itself that it wants to push in the world. And so they got hold of a bunch of emails from Hillary Clinton. They hacked into them. That's the story. I don't doubt that they do. I'm sure we are hacking them on a daily basis. And they released those emails sort of as a shot across Hillary's bow that we have this information on you and you better do what we want. Now that Trump won, it's a surprise to everybody else, now the people on the left have to make up a story to run down Donald Trump. And I'm not going to detail the deficiencies of Donald Trump. They're apparent. You know, but there are some good things that he's doing. So, but they have to undermine him at every move. They have to create the narrative. And the interesting thing that Trevor Loudon talked about, and then this article this week by Diana West, The Death of the Grown-Up and American Betrayal, who talked about communist infiltration in her latter book, American Betrayal, talked about communist infiltration into our government. The question is, if everybody's concerned about Trump's ties to Russia, why is nobody concerned about Obama's or Hillary Clinton's ties to Russia? I mean, listen, tell me one thing that Obama did on the geopolitical stage that did not advance the interest of Russia. You can't give me one. Everything he did, even though he looked incompetent at it, seemed to be, to me, designed to advance Russian interests. But look at what Hillary Clinton did. Hillary Clinton, when she was Secretary of State, she worked with Russia to set up essentially a technology zone to rival, to sort of recreate our Silicon Valley in Russia. And so Diane writes about this. It's called the Solkovo Foundation. And what she did was she went to tech companies in Silicon Valley, Google and others, to help set this up. And 17 tech companies went there, 16, and 16 of those were contributors to the Clinton Foundation. We also know that there was plutonium sold to Russia that Hillary Clinton had to approve. And it got approved amazingly. And so Russia ended up with excess plutonium that may, it appears, ending up in the hands of Iran, which is not good. So Diana West's point is, there's a few phone calls between Trump and Putin at most, or the Russian government, Trump operatives and Trump associates and the Russian government. There's a few phone calls, but there's massive corruption on the side of Hillary Clinton and Obama and the Russians. And does anybody else ever talk about that? And it's maddening. We also know that Bill Clinton went to Moscow and gave a speech. And for one speech, he was given $500,000. I just want two of those a year in case somebody wants to invite me out there. And so, and now this technology is being used to create hypersonic missiles. in Russia and China, which is really a game changer in terms of the safety of our Navy and other armed forces. These things will be a big problem. The left also goes after guys like, I don't have time to go in this, the Forward came out and attacked Sebastian Gorka. Kerr then came out and said Sebastian Gorka needs to be fired. He's anti-Semitic. There's absolutely no truth to that, but they just repeat this over and over through Twitter and through articles, and he belonged to some Hungarian thing, and people who've investigated this have come back and said there's nothing anti-Semitic or Nazi-like about Sebastian Gorka, but it's a narrative that the left pushes, and they're going to do it to everybody that gets in their way. So, in fact, Jerry Nadler is one of these guys. You see this? He tweeted this the other day. Must-read story, Ray. Nazi ties of top Trump aide. White House and Gorka silence in response is deafening. Let me tell you, one of the people identified in Enemies Within by Trevor Loudon as an infiltrator, communist infiltrator into our government, is Jerry Nadler. So I would say, after looking at that video, listening to Trevor talk, I would have been surprised if Jerry Nadler had not come out in support of it. I'm going to just mention this for perspective. This is called the Mercator projection of the world, and it's the map that most people use when they study the world. Now, there are some problems with it. It's a good map for sort of studying countries and spatial relationships. It's oriented around, you know, the zero meridian that goes through Greenwich, England. And so it looks like Europe's at the center of the world. And you notice up there, you see the size of ice, of Greenland? I mean, it's huge, right? Well, somebody came out and said, we really have not given you an accurate picture of the way the world really looks. This is what everybody studies. This is actually an accurate picture of the size of countries. And what do you see? You see Africa is big enough to include like United States and Canada, Argentina, China. It's huge. I mean, Asia is bigger, but Africa is about 80% of the size of North and South America combined. And you see India is not as big as you thought, and Greenland is about 1/14 the size that you see on the other maps. So now, it's interesting, in Boston they're taking this new map and they're saying, oh, the old map was done by colonial powers to make Africans feel less significant. And that's why they've been oppressed. That's another way that they've been oppressed. It's another thing that doesn't make any sense. So now, the rest of the time I'm going to talk about London, I'm going to talk about Middle East, and I'm going to talk about technocracy if I have time. So we know that there was this attack in London the other day. It hit the, you know, the news press as soon as it came out. It was all over the place. A man came from number one driving down across the bridge towards the Houses of Parliament. I've heard he ran over 40 people. He then turned, he ran into the gate there at Parliament, ran into the inner perimeter, stabbed the policeman who died, and then he was eventually shot dead. Interesting enough, the policeman that he stabbed was not armed, because that's the tradition in England. I would hope that they would think through that, because the man was essentially defensive. He had two long knives. One of the articles said that, and he used a app just before, it's called a WhatsApp, WATSAPP, and he posted a message. And so here's what the article says this morning. Meanwhile, at 2:37, Ajao was pausing to send a final message to someone via the mobile messaging service WhatsApp. Whom he was messaging and the content of the message have not yet been released, but it is likely to be a vital clue in the hunt for accomplices. However, police are expected to have difficulty accessing the contents, which were encrypted, and cybersecurity experts say they will have to employ their own hackers to get to the information as to what he sent to somebody and to who he sent it. One of the people killed near the number two part there was a one lady, she was knocked off the bridge. She's still in the hospital. There was an American couple there. A lady hit knocked under a bus. She was killed. There was an American couple there celebrating their 25th wedding anniversary. It was sort of the last thing they were doing before they went back to the U.S. the next day, and he was struck and killed, and I believe his wife was injured. But there is this narrative that's being pushed about this London attack that I find extremely troubling. England has its own problems. There's a pro-Israel speaker who pulled out of a conference at a college or university in County Cork because of one of the people being there is a rabid anti-Semite and is associated with the guy who did that report that I talked about last week that they tried to publish for the UN. I got a copy of it, and it's all anti-Israel screed. So what happened after this attack is that they locked down Parliament. It was said that Theresa May, the Prime Minister of England, was about 40 yards away from where this occurred. And so they went into Parliament, and they talked about it in the British Parliament. And here is Theresa May talking about the attack.
As generations have done before us, and as future generations will continue to do, to deliver a simple message: we are not afraid, and our resolve will never waver in the face of terrorism. A terrorist came to the place where people of all nationalities and cultures gather to celebrate what it means to be free. And he took out his rage indiscriminately against innocent men, women, and children. Mr. Speaker, it is still believed that this attacker acted alone, and the police have no reason to believe there are imminent further attacks on the public. His identity is known to the police and MI5, and when operational considerations allow, he will be publicly identified. What I can confirm is that the man was British-born, and that some years ago, he was once investigated by MI5 in relation to concerns about violent extremism. He was a
And she goes on to say he was a peripheral part of that. Now look, so what do you hear from the narrative that Theresa May, there's some things I like about her, but listen, she's just dead wrong on the way she's approaching this. She's not telling the truth. He was British born. He had been investigated. He was known to the government. But I doubt that he acted alone. But this is the narrative. And the narrative continued throughout a little bit more of the thing in Parliament when members of Parliament were allowed to get up and question Prime Minister. Now, almost every one of them agreed with her. And here's just the last little bit of that exchange.
That we will not be cowed, as the Prime Minister put it so eloquently. Does she agree that we will also need to show the same determination to stand up against anyone who seeks to sow division or to stir up hatred in the wake of these cowardly attacks?
I absolutely agree with the Right Honourable Gentleman. We must be very clear that the voices of evil and hate will not divide us. That should also be a clear message from this House today.
Michael Tomlinson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is reported that what happened yesterday was an act of Islamic terror. Will the Prime Minister agree with me that what happened was not Islamic, just as the murder of Airy Neave was not Christian, and that in fact both are perversions of religion?
I absolutely agree. And it is wrong to describe this as Islamic terrorism. It is Islamist terrorism. It is a perversion of a great faith.
Well, and that continued. A perversion of a great faith. And so this is the narrative that happens. And so I'm concerned that if this happened in the United States, I'm confident that most of the people involved would describe it this way. I think that President Trump might not use that kind of language, which I think is creating a false narrative. The Independent came out, and they had all these titles throughout their article. The worst response to this attack would be to further ramp up rhetorical excess. An operation with elements from the ISIS playbook. Terror wins if we lose our sense of perspective over the threat it poses. Now, I'm going to play you a couple clips. Now, I think I edited out all the bad words. These are very highly emotional times, and so I'm pretty sure I got them all. But people get very emotional. The first person will be from UKIP, United Kingdom Independence Party, I think is the name of it. Nigel Farage is a member of it. This man is named, I think it's Daniel Nuttall. And he's going to talk about, and I think he has a better perspective. Here's what he says.
I don't think there's any coincidence that this attack took place a year to the day after the Brussels attacks, which obviously us as European Parliament representatives were involved in. You know, there is a cancer within our community in this country that has to be cut out and has to be dealt with. And whether that is calling on the Muslim community to do more to cut this cancer out, whether it's ensuring that those 800 British citizens who are fighting for ISIS out in Syria and Iraq aren't allowed back in this country, or indeed down the line, whether the government goes down the route of banning Saudi funding of mosques, because quite frankly, Saudi Arabia spread radicalism around the globe.
So here's what we pick up from him, who gave us some facts. Some of those facts are that 800 British citizens holding British passports have gone to Iraq and Syria and fought for ISIS, got trained, and come back to England, to live in England. There are hundreds of people that are surveilled 24 hours a day in England. Guess what religion they almost all belong to? And it is a cancer. And some of the response, the question of the man at the last question in Parliament, was to respond to what he had said, it's a cancer that needs to be cut out. Now, the former head of the UKIP party was on Tucker Carlson, Nigel Farage, and this is what he had to say the night of the attack.
So it seems clear from this vantage that this is part of something much larger, and it's pretty clear what it is. I wonder if that's as clear to the leaders of the political parties in Great Britain.
Well, I remember about 5 years ago, I said that we had a fifth column living inside our own nation. It was the first time in our history that we had people living amongst us that wanted to destroy our values and actually even wanted to kill us. And I remember the absolute wave of condemnation that I came in for. What I've seen today are a lot of people, the great and the good of this country, the people that did irresponsibly open the doors, the people that refused to accept that within some parts of Islam there was a growing problem, and they're all saying how awful and appalling it is. And I do actually think that the moment has come for us to actually point the blame. You know, what these politicians have done in the space of just 15 years may well affect the way we live in this country for the next 100 years.
Well, I mean, I don't think there's any question, and Great Britain is not alone in that. Is there still a sanction against those who say what you just said in public in Great Britain? I know that's been true for a long time. If you say that out loud, somehow you're the bad guy. Is that still the case?
Well, I was the other week doing a radio show here, and I talked about Sweden. I talked about Malmo being the rape capital of Europe, and I'm currently under investigation by Ofcom, who are the regulator here for all broadcast media. Now, I don't anticipate receiving a heavy fine, but it just goes to show, doesn't it, that actually we do not quite enjoy free speech in this country in the way in which we should.
No, the country that invented it no longer has it. But what's the, I mean, if you, just to ask you to play psychiatrist for 1 second, what's the thinking here? Why would the leaders of a country whose job it is to protect the citizens who voted for them be so angry at anybody calling, you know, things as they see it, telling the truth? Why is that a threat to them?
Well, this was when Tony Blair got elected back in 1997. His aim was to create a genuinely multicultural society. In fact, he said he wanted to rub the noses of the right in diversity. Peter Mandelson, one of the architects of New Labour, said we sent out search parties all over the world to find as many immigrants as we possibly could. And, you know, look, I'm not against immigration. I want us to have sensible, managed, balanced immigration. But for goodness sake, you have to vet people. And that was 20 years ago. And, you know, today, when Donald Trump, and surely this is the big takeout, is that when Donald Trump tries to make America safer, when Donald Trump tries to make sure that these scenes that we've had in Paris and Brussels and Berlin and now London aren't repeated in America, we get people on Fifth Avenue and behind me in Westminster, out on the streets protesting. It seems to me that our political leaders really ought to start saying sorry.
Yeah, I'm not sure any society's ever behaved the way Western societies are behaving now in this masochistic way. So what are the specific lessons for U.S. policymakers in the wake of something like this?
There are two, I think. The first is to be desperately careful about who you let into your country. And yes, I know the vast majority, 80% plus, you know, of Muslims living in Britain, according to our surveys, want to be integrated and respect our way of life. And the last thing we need to do is to alienate them. But you can't have open-door immigration and not bring in terrorism. That's point one, and that's exactly what the president is trying to do. The second problem are that some of those communities that exist within our countries are, and I'm quoting Britain here as an example, through our state-run schools and our prisons being radicalized. It's hard to believe, isn't it, that actually in British prisons it's now one of the major sources of Islamic terrorist recruitment. And frankly, we've simply got to get tough, and we've got to give our security services all the weapons that they need to try and counter this threat.
Good luck, and God bless you tonight. Nigel Farage, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay, so what do we know? Now, when Nigel Farage gave that talk on Thursday night, Wednesday, whenever the attack happened, I guess maybe it was Wednesday, that night, nobody knew who the attacker was. It's interesting that the man was British-born, converted to Islam, but had spent a lot of time in prison in England, being radicalized. Then he went to Saudi Arabia, where he was further radicalized under their Wahhabist thought that's there, and then he came back to England, no problems, and had some problems with violence. So this is no surprise. They knew who this guy was. He'd been on their radar. He'd been questioned before. Here's Ayan Hirsi Ali, who grew up in Islamic Somalia and fled to Netherlands, now lives in the United States. I think she's at Harvard. Here's just a short clip of what she had to say the same night on Tucker.
Why is it that so many on the left internationally, in this country, in Great Britain, all through Europe, have so much trouble coming to terms with the religious component of this violence?
I don't know. I acknowledge, as you do, that it's masochistic, it's stupid. And I think that if you look at the Islamists, they don't go to the liberals and say, thank you so much for letting us, you know, take over. We'll stop terrorizing you. they don't do it.
Here's just a little bit more of her.
They want one thing, and that is a Sharia-compliant society and eventually the world. That's what their aim is. It sounds crazy to you and me and everyone else, but that's their objective. And they want to get there through dawah. This is an infrastructure of indoctrinating people into accepting it, and other ways of intimidating and, you know, forcing them to do it, and jihad, violence. And whoever is in their way is their enemy. And it doesn't matter how nice the liberals are, how accommodating and obliging they are, that's the objective of the Islamist. And if you don't understand that, then I don't think you should be in the business of making legislation or in the business of, you know, the leadership of, in thought leadership. Because you.
Well, that's, and she knows. I mean, she was, she's a very brave lady. And I like her comment, the basic comment I took away from that. If you won't talk about this the way it is, you shouldn't be in leadership, and you're stupid. I mean, I think that's a good comment. Of course, ISIS has claimed responsibility for this. Even The Atlantic, which is a magazine to the left, had this article this morning, why the London attacker was no lone wolf. Now, maybe he didn't have somebody with him that day, but there's operational support that's given to these people. In National Review, Andy McCarthy, who prosecuted the blind sheikh with regard to the first World Trade Center bombing, has studied Islam, and here's what he says in his article. I'll read part of this. It was a careful choice of words, Bernard Lewis being nothing if not careful, Bernard Lewis being one of the great historians on Islam in the West. In 2004, the West audibly gasped when its preeminent scholar of Islam famously told the German newspaper, Die Welt, Europe will be Islamic by the end of the century, if not sooner. Listen carefully. He did not say that Muslims will be the majority population in what is still recognizably Europe. No, Professor Lewis said, Europe will be Islamic. And in Theresa May, that is Islamic, not Islamist. Andy continues, we are not talking about Muslims here. We're talking about Islam. Lots of individual Muslims desire peaceful coexistence, even assimilation. But Islam's aim is to prevail. So yet this week, Louis Foreboding has been brought to the fore by a jihadist mass murder attack, this time in London. There immediately began the ritual media pondering over Massoud's, that's the terrorist's, motive. Yes, what could it possibly have been? I'm going to stick with the patently obvious. During at least one of the resulting stints in prison, that where this guy was, like many inmates, he began indoctrination into Islam. Between 2004 and 2005 came the critical transition, the formal conversion, marriage to a Muslim woman, and relocation to Saudi Arabia, you know, our ally against terrorism. For 5 years, Massoud was immersed in the kingdom's Wahhabism, fundamentalist Islam rooted in scriptural literalism. He became an English language teacher working for the Saudi government. Massoud returned to England from Jeddah about 7 years ago. By the time of Wednesday's attack on Westminster Bridge, he had seamlessly gravitated to Birmingham, a city increasingly enveloped by Sharia enclaves that, to varying degrees, have become de facto, not de jure, not by operation law, but by operation of the facts, no-go zones for non-Muslims and agents of the state, including police. There is diversity in Islam, including millions of Muslims who adhere to its spiritual elements or see themselves as more culturally than doctrinally Islamic. But when we speak of Islam as opposed to Muslims, we are not talking about a mere religious belief system. We are talking about a competing civilization that is very much how Islam self-identifies. It has its own history, principles, values, mores, and legal system. Islam, thus understood, is not non-Western. It is anti-Western. Naturally, Islamic State took credit for it. Last sentence there. Western leaders have been content to accept these claims, at least as inspirational, if not operational. It is easier to indulge the fiction that ISIS catalyzes jihadism than to ask what catalyzed ISIS. But the remorseless fact is that before ISIS and Al-Qaeda and the Khomeini Revolution and Hezbollah and the Blind Sheikh and the Brotherhood and Khalid Massoud, there was the single thing that unites them all. There was Islam. Western political and opinion elites remain willfully blind to this. They cannot help but project onto Islamic beliefs and practices their own progressive pieties, which take seriously neither religion nor the notion that there is any civilization but their own. And in that article, he goes on to talk about Birmingham. Birmingham, there was a survey done in 2007 because there are a lot of Muslim people settling in Birmingham, England. And it's become sort of a hotbed for Islam and Islamic radicalism. In that survey, it was determined that projected that Muslims would be the majority in Birmingham by 2030. And what happened? People saw that, and a lot of non-Muslim people left. More Muslim people moved in. Sharia compliant areas were set up. That allowed polygamists to occur. They came in, they had more and more babies, more and more people left. And so now what is the projection for when it was 2030 in 2007? This is why I say when you see these projections, you need to move them closer to us as to them coming true, like Muslim becoming as many people as Christians in the world, and that includes Catholicism. They say that's 2050 in a recent Foreign Affairs or Foreign Policy magazine on demographics. I think it comes a lot sooner. 2030 in Birmingham, 2018 or 2019 is when it will be majority Muslim. 12 years sooner than they projected just 10 years ago. And this is true all over. Europe turned 60 this week. I know a lot of people think that Europe is the final beast empire. I'm open to that, but it's falling apart, and I just don't see it coming back as a power. But other people have, as this article in the New York Times today says, getting back together, that will not be easy. Today, the enlarged European Union is poorer, more diverse, and less united than ever. Its troubles are so numerous and structural that they threaten to undo the bloc. Okay. I want to back up. I'm going to exit out of this for just a second. There was a video that I wanted to play that I did edit. Excuse me for this. Of course, now it wants to save the presentation. There we go. There's a man in England. He's head of a, they call it a racist party. His name is Tommy Hunter. So I want you to understand that, you know, people call him a Nazi and all that thing. And he can be a bit extreme. But okay, give me 1 second. I want to make sure I'm not stepping into something that I don't want to. Okay, well, I'll try to stop it if I didn't. It's not, it's a part of the anatomy that you sit on. So it's in the Bible, but some people. Okay, so here is this. This happened, they were doing an interview, the Rebel Media, the Rebel, with Tommy Hunter, and the attack happened, and so they went out on the street to film this.
We've been here for about 20 minutes now, and we don't have any updates on specifically what's happened, but what we do know, based on all the reports, is that a car has plowed through Westminster Bridge and crashed into the Houses of Parliament. Gunshots have been fired within the gates, and three people have been confirmed dead. I don't think this is any surprise to anybody watching this. The question on everybody's lips is, who is responsible for this? And I don't think it's going to be surprising when we found out. Sky News has already reported that the man who did this was of Asian origin, which I don't think is very surprising to anybody. If you import a culture, you get a culture. This is a culture of violence, destruction, and terrorism, and there should be no surprise when we see it on our streets. Tommy, what do you have to say about what's just happened?
Now, what you're going to see is a lot of the left-wing media start gathering around and other people. Because when Tommy Hunter shows up, everybody comes to protest him. Okay? They don't protest the guy that ran over people and killed 4 or 5 people. They protest Tommy Hunter. And look, he's very passionate about what he believes. You'll see this.
Just going through, as I said, as we're walking around here, we've gone past young people, young girls with blankets over them from the shock. This isn't a shock to me. I don't understand who people who are surprised by this. We've had 12 suspected terrorist attacks planned last year. If they would have been successful, you'd have seen shopping centres, you'd have seen aeroplanes, you'd have seen nightclubs, you'd have seen a war zone on our streets, similar to this, every single month. Then, and only then, might people realise we are at war. We're in war already. We have over 3,000 Muslims who are monitored 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Every week, cost of £9 billion a year. Yeah? We're following and waiting for them to do this. We have had 450 ISIS fighters been allowed to return to our country. They've gone and fought for ISIS. They've been in training camps. They've been beheading people. They've been raping people. And they're walking the streets of our capital city. They're living with us. Our government have failed us. Don't come out and act all strong on this, Home Secretary, Theresa May, because you haven't been strong. You've been weak. You've showed cowardice. Okay? This is an Islamic Jihad attack. The man that done this would have either been radicalised in a prison or he would have been radicalised on the streets of the UK with full knowledge of our government and our security services. They will know who he is. I have information that shows there was 4 terrorist attacks last week in France. 4 in France. There was 12 planned last year. Driving your car like this man has done is exactly what the Inspire magazine, which is Al-Qaeda's magazine, which was downloaded by 50,000 British Muslims last year. 50,000 British Muslims downloaded a terrorist manual in our country. 50,000. Not 10, not 20. 50,000 people who want to see exactly what you see there. That's what they want. They want war, they want death, they want destruction. And we keep on pandering like you just come up to me saying it's got nothing to do with Islam. It's got everything to do with Islam.
I'm simply asking how you're sure of the political
I'm on the reality. This is the reality. The reality is this is a war. These people are waging war on us for time. This has gone on for 1,400 years. This is nothing new. And the whole time while this goes on, police leaders or political leaders want to invite more. They want to invite more.
The blood is on the hands of people like you and the left, who have allowed these people to come into our country and caused chaos. There are going to be knocks on the door of families tonight saying that their daughters, their mothers, and their family have probably been maimed and killed in the streets of our own capital. And the left have allowed it to go unnoticed. And we have people like this laughing hysterically.
Yep, there's a lady there laughing at him. So look, this is a huge problem, and I think Andy McCarthy is right. I think Tommy Hunter is right, whether you agree with him or not. So let's look at a little bit about Israel and the Middle East and the time that we have remaining. This is a settlement called Mount Adumim. I'm sure I don't say that correctly, in the West Bank. And there's talk about annexing it into Israel. It will be a big problem. You can see it here on the right. Effectively, what this will do is it will cut off the southern part of what we call the West Bank and the northern part of the West Bank. Now, part of this is in a response to the projection that they're going to try to make Israel only 9 miles wide at one point. Very, very dangerous. And so Israel's responding sort of in kind, that you're going to do that to us, we're going to do that to you. We're going to make it difficult for you to get around. Interestingly enough, the UN Secretary General came out this week and said, yeah, there is a temple in Jerusalem, and the temple was Jewish. And he undermined the things of his own the UN Human Rights Council, that said that. They did vote this week. On Friday, they adopted 5 anti-Israel resolutions. I saw this on Twitter. This is all the anti-Palestinian and anti-Arab posts from Israel. They're monitoring all these Twitter and Facebook posts and counting them. At the Human Rights Council, when they put this on notice, the British came out and said, we're tired of this. Now, they voted in favor of a couple of these stupid resolutions. But they said the UN Human Rights Council is biased. Here's the statement that Britain issued, and the United States issued a much shorter but similar, something in a similar vein. Israel's a population of 8 million versus in a world of 7 billion. Yet since its foundation, the Human Rights Council has adopted 135 countrywide, country-specific resolutions. 68, more than half, of which are against Israel. Justice is blind and impartial. This selective focus on Israel is neither. Israel is the only country permanently on the Human Rights Council agenda. They get an agenda of atrocities and things they're going to talk about. Israel is on every agenda. It's the only country. Saudi Arabia is in Pakistan, China, Venezuela. None of those are, but Israel is. Nowhere is a disproportionate focus on Israel starker and more absurd than the case of today's resolution on the occupation of Syria's Golan. Syria's regime butchers and murders its people on a daily basis. But it is not Syria that is a permanent standing item on the Council's agenda. It is Israel. We cannot accept the perverse message sent out by a Syrian Golan resolution that signals out Israel as Assad continues to slaughter the Syrian people. And so here's a video. You can turn this up. UN Watch responded to all of these anti-Israel statements that were made at the...
Israel continues to exercise apartheid in Palestine, which...
You know, they all come out. Israel's anti-apartheid. Apartheid, apartheid,
and terrorism that are being exercised against the Palestinians.
Here is the man from UN Watch who spoke very passionately about Israel.
Mr. President, let me begin by putting the following on the record. Everything we just heard from the world's worst abusers of human rights, of women's rights, of freedom of religion, of the press, of assembly, of speech, is absolutely false and indeed Orwellian. Today's report does not consider Israelis to be deserving of human rights, consistent with the approach of this council, where today's notorious agenda item against Israel completely ignores their human rights. Now, over the weekend, President Abbas announced he was giving his highest medal to Rima Khalaf, who resigned from the Economic Commission of Western Asia, a Beirut-based UN agency of 18 Arab states, after Secretary General Guterres rightly instructed her to remove an absurd report which accused Israel of, quote, apartheid. Mr. President, why is Mr. Abbas celebrating a report written by the notorious Richard Falk, after his own Palestinian mission here tried in 2010 to remove Mr. Falk on the basis that he was, quote, a partisan of Hamas, as we know from WikiLeaks. The accusation against Israel is absurd. Israel's 1.5 million Arabs...
Delegation of Palestine has the floor.
Now they
more
try to shut it down.
One statement goes beyond the...
For what he says. Egypt weighs in, Pakistan, great human rights countries there. So here he goes.
Those 1.5 million Arabs, whatever challenges they face, enjoy full rights to vote and to be elected in the Knesset. They work as doctors and lawyers. They serve on the Supreme Court. Now, I'd like to ask the members of that commission that commissioned that report, the Arab states from which we just heard, Egypt, Iraq, and the others, how many Jews live in your countries? How many Jews lived in Egypt, Iraq, Jordan, Kuwait, Lebanon, Libya, Morocco? Once upon a time, the Middle East was full of Jews. Algeria had 140,000 Jews. Algeria, where are your Jews? Egypt used to have 75,000 Jews. Where are your Jews? Syria, you had tens of thousands of Jews. Where are your Jews? Iraq, you had over 135,000 Jews. Where are your Jews? Mr. President, where is the real apartheid? Why is there a UN commission on the Middle East that does not include Israel? From the 1960s and the 70s, they refused to include Israel. Where is the apartheid, Mr. President?
Well, you can find that on the UN Watch YouTube channel. Nathan Sharansky has been a defender or a challenger of anti-Semitism for many years. And he makes a good point in the, and we know that this is prophesied, that the nations will be aligned against Israel and against the Jews in the end time. They'll be persecuted. It says this. I mean, Jesus talked about it. All the prophets talked about it. And the Sharansky talked about, why do we have this anti-Semitism? And he makes a good point that for a long time we've had globalization. And when globalization was at the top, anti-Semitism rose because the nation state, particularly the nation state of Israel, became sort of a colonial artifact left over. Now we have nationalism rising. He says globalization brought some very positive things for the world and for the Jews. It helped with their smooth integration, but it also brought challenges for Israel. It's clear there must be some balance between globalism and nationalism. Pure globalism without nationalism would fail, and pure nationalism without globalism failed long ago. Good point. This is from the Daily Mail. This is in the wrong place, but these nano drones that they're building, these small insect-sized drones that can carry very powerful explosives, could be, the Daily Mail says, the end of humanity. Now, we know how humanity, things come to an end, but this rise of this technology is very troubling. We know that the U.S. and Britain banned laptops on Middle East flights in an anti-terror push this week. In Mosul, the battle for Mosul is ongoing. They have moved in, they've captured East Mosul, they're moving to West Mosul, but now they've stopped because there was this report of heavy civilian casualties, some U.S. airstrikes that may have killed up to 200 civilians. Mosul will eventually, it's going to be a major problem. Foreign Policy has a good article, Goodbye Islamic State, Hello Anarchy. So if we get rid of Islamic State and Raqqa and Mosul, what replaces them? So you have a Sunni, probably what's left there is a Sunni majority population. The people that are coming in, the Iraqi militias and the Kurds, the Iraqi militias are all Shiite. And the belief is it's going to be total anarchy. In fact, what's now happening is that these various Shiite militias, everybody's fighting, they're fighting each other, and ISIS is sitting there just sending out suicide bombers to take care of everything, and it's chaos. So they've stopped the advance into West Mosul right now. I think it's going to be a fairly long operation. The fighting continues for West Mosul, the last major urban bastion for Islamic State in Iraq. But the military forces that drove the jihadi group out of the east are now competing for influence once against another rather than cooperating to maintain order. The rivalry among these groups is coming at the expense of efforts to combat Islamic State sleeper cells, which have launched a campaign of suicide bombings in liberated areas. There is no plan in the government of Iraq after Mosul. I have not seen one. The style of leading the country is fly by night. Is a good article in Israel Haman. I don't have a time to read this, talking about that it is a two-state solution is a existential threat for Israel. That's from the ex-Mossad chief. So there's a lot of discussion in Israel. Do we have one state, two states? What do we do? One of the writers who wrote in response to this noted an old report from about 13 years ago called the million-person gap. Because you see, what they say is, if we make it a two-state, or we make it a one-state, you're going to have roughly 50% Arabs and 50% Jews in between the Jordan and the Mediterranean. But this report looks at a demographic report, and Caroline Glicks talks about this in her book, The Israeli Solution. It talks about the fact that when they did these surveys, the last time they did detailed demographic surveys of the Arabs in the West Bank, they came up with there was a gap of over 1 million people between what the Palestinian authorities said were there and what they actually could justify were there. So maybe they're not 50-50. I think the Jews have a big, and their birth rates are falling. So 1.34 million person gap is what they found. They looked at a bunch of demographic material, and they just couldn't come up with the right number. They also looked at projected birth rates, and the birth rates never went up, is I think the point of that graph. There's no sound on this video. To show you the problem with the two-state, though, this is Highway 6, the cross-national Israeli highway. It goes north to south from Hebron all the way up to, I think, Haifa. But look at how close, here the red line is the proposed 67 borders that they want the Palestinian state to be. So this is their major north-south highway. And look how close it comes to the border of a Palestinian state. Here's Highway 6. There's a security barrier. There's the area designated. It's only 200 feet, roughly. And we know that they have all of these tunnels that they built. And so this is a problem. I mean, if they make a state like that, now they'll try to do it, but the Palestinians aren't going to cooperate with that. And so somebody could probably throw a grenade 200 feet, I think. The highway, you couldn't use the highway. It would be shut down all the time. Okay, a couple more things. The situation to the north of Israel in the area that is identified in Ezekiel 38 and 39 as the mountains of northern Israel, is very volatile. On the Golan side, you have ISIS, you have the Syrian armies, you have some jihadi groups, you have Hezbollah, and then in Lebanon, you had Hezbollah. But for a long time, there was sort of a standoff with Hezbollah and the Lebanese government. Hezbollah was sort of considered to be part of what we're about, maybe helping defend ourselves, but they don't have control of things. They're not their own boss. That has changed. There's an article out this week. Hezbollah has completed the process of usurping the Lebanese state. This is from the Jerusalem Center for Public Affairs. Has completed the process of usurping the Lebanese state and its institutions. The election of Michael Announ as president through a forced arrangement with Hezbollah has fulfilled the Iranian vision of controlling Lebanon without changing the power equation as prevailed there since the National Pact. And what the pact was, there was a role for Hezbollah. The leader of Lebanon would always be a Maronite Christian. And that has changed. And now they're saying that on February 12th, the president said this, as long as a part of the territory is occupied by Israel, which also has covetousness in Lebanese natural resources, and as long as the army is not powerful enough to face Israel, we feel the need to maintain Hezbollah's weapons. these weapons complement the action of the army. This was a real game changer in saying that Lebanon, Hezbollah, had a valid role. Caroline Glick picked up on this in her article. There's actually another article at the Investigative Project on Terrorism. World shrugs as Hezbollah prepares massive civilian deaths. We showed you the video last week where Hezbollah is showing places that it can strike with its rockets, including the Dimona nuclear facility in down in the Negev in southern Israel. So Caroline Glick talks about this week in the context of sort of world geopolitics and calls it, her article, Trump's greatest deal. What can be done about Iran? She says, in Israel, a dispute is reportedly raging between the IDF and the Mossad about the greatest threat facing Israel. IDF Chief of General Staff, Lieutenant General Gadi Eisenkot, thinks that Hezbollah is the greatest threat. Mossad Director Yossi Cohen thinks that Israel's nuclear program is the greatest danger facing the nuclear state. While the media highlight the two men's disagreement, the underlying truth about their concerns has been ignored. Hezbollah and Iran's nuclear program are two aspects of the same threat. As somebody would say, two wings of the same bird, the regime in Tehran. Hezbollah is a wholly owned subsidiary of the regime. If that regime disappeared, Hezbollah would fall apart. As for the nuclear installations in the hands of less fanatical leaders, they would represent a far less acute danger to global security. So if you undermine the Iranian regime, you defeat Hezbollah and defuse the nuclear threat. If you fail to deal with the regime in Tehran, both threats will continue to grow no matter what you do until they become all but insurmountable. So what can be done about Tehran? With each passing day, we discover new ways to Iran endangers Israel and the rest of the region. This week, we learned Iran has built underground weapons facilities in Lebanon. The facilities are reportedly capable of building missiles, drones, and small arms ammunition. Their underground location protects them from aerial bombardments. This is very troubling. How's Israel going to deal with this problem? How are they going to go into Gaza when there's multiple tunnels? How are they going to do that when there's multiple underground installations in Lebanon? And you put a ground force in there, those guys can pop up just like they're doing in Mosul. If you see what's going on in Mosul, that's a picture of what's going to go on in Lebanon. And by the way, these guys have gone to ISIS. They've gone back to Iran, to England and other places. There are reports, I think Amir Sarfati talked about this yesterday, that they're taking back components of chemical weapons and weapons of mass destruction with them to be assembled later in the West. And that may be why part of this ban has been put on the type of things that can come through that you can carry onto the plane. Caroline goes back, never an easy claim. The Lebanese Air Force provided targeting information to Hezbollah missile crews attacking Israel in 2006. After Hezbollah domesticated the Lebanese government in 2008, the claim became downright silly. Yet the U.S. has continued to provide them with millions and millions of dollars of weapons. These are believed, they're ending up in the hands of Hamas. They've been seen in parades. Here's the key point. And I think this goes about why there's all this push to tie Trump to Russia. Obama empowered Iran at the expense of the U.S. Sunni allies in Israel, and indeed at the expense of the U.S.'s own superpower status in the region to enable the former president to withdraw the U.S. from the Middle East. Power, of course, doesn't suffer a vacuum, and the one that Obama created was quickly filled. For decades, Russia has been Iran's major arms supplier. It has assisted Iran with its nuclear program and with its ballistic missile program. Russia serves as Iran's loyal protector at the UN Security Council. But for all the help provided Tehran through the years, Moscow never presented itself as Iran's military defender. That all changed in September 2015. 2 months after Obama cut his nuclear deal with the Ayatollahs, Russia deployed its forces to Syria on behalf of Iran and its Syrian and Lebanese proxies. In so doing, Russia became the leading member and the protector of the Iranian axis. In his final year in office, Obama's greatest concern was ensuring that his nuclear deal with Iran would outlive his presidency. Russia's deployment in Syria as the protector of Iran and its proxies was a means of achieving this end. Russia's alliance with Iran made attacking Iran's nuclear program or its Hezbollah proxy a much more dangerous prospect than it had been before. And this is why I say that this is Obama does this Iran deal, and who benefits? Russia. I mean, everything he did benefited Russia on a geopolitical foreign policy standpoint that I can determine. Israel's ability to continue to strike targets in Syria, whether along the border on the Golan Heights or deep within Syrian territory, is a function of Netanyahu's success in convincing Putin to limit his commitment to his Iranian allies. Since President Trump entered the White House, Iran has been the most urgent foreign policy challenge. Unlike Obama, Trump recognizes that Iran's nuclear program and its threats of U.S. economic and strategic interest in the Persian Gulf and the Levant cannot be wished away, and so he has decided to deal with Iran. The question is, what is he supposed to do? Trump has three basic options. He can cut a deal with Russia, he can act against Iran without cutting a deal, or third, he can do nothing or anemically maintain Obama's pro-Iran policies. The problem with Russia's strategy is that since Trump defeated Hillary Clinton in the presidential race, the Democrats, their allied media outlets, and powerful forces in the U.S. intelligence community have been beset by a Russian hysteria unseen since the Red Scares in the 1920s and 30s, 50s. The fact that Obama bent over backward to cater to Putin's interests for 8 years has been pushed down the memory hole, similar to what Diana West said. Also ignores the fact that during her tenure as Secretary of State, Clinton approved deals with the Russians that were arguably antithetical to U.S. interests, while the Clinton Foundation received millions of dollars in contributions from Russian businessmen and companies closely allied with Putin. This brings us to the second option, which is to confront Iran and Russia. Under this option, U.S. action against Iran could easily cause hostilities to break out between the U.S. and Russia. It goes without saying that the political fallout for making a deal with Russia would be nothing compared to the political consequences if Trump were to take the U.S. down a path that led to war with Russia. Obviously, the economic and human costs of such a confrontation would be prohibitive, regardless of the political consequences. This leaves the final option of doing nothing. Although tempting, the hard truth is that this is the most dangerous policy of all. You need only to look at North Korea, to understand why this is so. Israel has moved Russia as far away from Iran as it can on its own. It is enough to stop convoys of North Korean weapons from crossing into Lebanon. But that article in the Jerusalem Center for Policy Analysis said that people in Lebanon affiliated with Hezbollah are saying, yeah, Israel's blown up a few of those convoys, but dozens have gotten through that they've not been able to attack. And so there's a major problem in the north of Israel. Israel is getting squeezed. The Iran deal Trump needs to make with the Russians is clear. The only question is whether he's willing to pay the political price. Because what's happening here is Russia is asserting tremendous influence all over the Middle East. The Saudis are starting to align with Russia. You have the issues with Turkey, Iran. This is all a very complicated situation. They're making a naval base. They're building that naval base up in Syria on the coast. Haaretz posted today, or for Financial Times, Israeli air raids in Syria raised fears of a wider conflict. So what do we make all this? The title of the thing today was The Time of the Signs. And all these things we know that are going to unfold, I think, are becoming a little bit clearer as to how they're going to happen. The nations are aligning the way that prophecy says they will. Things are happening in the world and culture. I don't have time to go into the technocracy thing today. I will say this. We know that there is this thing called the mark of the beast coming. Scripture is not clear exactly how that comes about. Even National Geographic is talking about the next human. How are we going to evolve ourselves to a better person? And we know that there will be this technology in place. I talked a little bit about this conference last week that took place in Barcelona. I have some more clips to play for you from that. But I have one thing that I want to show you, a slide from one of the presentations. It talks about the birth of superintelligence, the global brain. But look at this slide. This slide contains 12 risks. This was in one of the talks by the head of SoftBank. 12 risks that threaten human civilization. Global pandemic, ecological collapse, nuclear war, synthetic biology, nanotechnology, super volcano, unknown consequences, major asteroid impact, bad global governance, global system collapse, extreme climate change, and artificial intelligence. Now, I can tell you that I find this very interesting because it sounds like the guy went to the Book of Revelation and pulled out all of the things that threaten human civilization. Because all of these things really are prophesied in the chapters of the Book of Revelation. Artificial intelligence is the interesting one. The one, and he says, that's a threat to human civilization, but we think we're smart enough to control that. There were people back at the time of the Tower of Babel that felt the same way. They were smart enough. Nothing will be impossible for us. It's the same thing repeating. It's being recapitulated right in front of our eyes. It's what's prophesied. And we know what the ultimate solution is. It's Jesus' return to set up his kingdom. But man thinks we're going to make a better human, more intelligent, and we're going to become really as a god. And so this, I think this bears its own long presentation, but I just find it interesting when secular world talks about the things that we talk about here. Here they'll call us haters and crazy, but really, they're talking about the same thing too. They're talking about a possible apocalypse. So, but we have the answers. So let's pray and let's move forward. Father, again, thanks so much for your word and the guidance that it gives. Lord, I just pray that you will, if anybody's listening to this today who's never made themselves right with God by accepting the free gift of salvation by grace through faith in Jesus Christ and his finished work on the cross, I pray that you would use this to prompt them to make that decision as time is very short. Bless us as we go this week. In Jesus' name, amen.